Hello, my dear students. I hope you people are fine. So in this video, let us continue with few more topics of internet and open source concepts. In our previous video, we had already completed with some of the criteria of open source software. We have seen what is the difference between OSS and free software. What does FLOSS stand for? Certain organizations like GNU, FSF and OSI. So let us move on with the concept that is W3C, which actually stands for Worldwide Web Consortium. It is the consortium that is responsible for producing the software standards for World Wide Web. That means this World Wide Web was actually being created in October 1994 by the Tim Berners-Lee. In order to lead the World Wide Web to its fullest potential, certain common protocols were being developed, like, you know, hypertext transfer protocol. Okay, that promotes its evolution and it ensures the interoperability. That means this consortium, W3C consortium, supported the World Wide Web in order to have its evolution and ensure its interoperability. Interoperability means it's the ability of the computer system or the software in order to exchange or make use of the information available in the particular software to the public through the World Wide Web. Okay, so it was making all those softwares available to the public with the help of World Wide Web. The standards were being set by the W3C consortium. Okay, moving on to the next topic, that is, what is proprietary software? A very interesting one. Proprietary software is the kind of a software that is neither open nor it is freely available. You can say that it's a licensed software. Its use is regulated and it is distributed, and modification is completely forbidden. Okay, that requires certain special kind of permission from the developer or the vendor. Okay, proprietary software is a kind of a software, neither it's an open source. Open source means that allows you to download the source code, isn't it? It's neither the open source nor it is freely available. That means it is completely, you know, a kind of, you know, fee based it is, proprietary software, where the distribution and modifications are completely forbidden. Means it is not allowed to make any kind of modifications, neither you cannot sell the software to anybody. If you want to do so, you have to require the permission from the suppliers or the developers. I can give an example, like Adobe Photoshop, Windows, WinRAR. Okay, you can see here iTunes, Microsoft Office, Skype, all these are the examples for the proprietary software. You can also call the proprietary software as the closed source software because it's a non-free computer software. These are all the non-free computers, sorry. These are all the non-free computer software. Hence, you can call them as the closed source softwares. It's actually the copyrighted ones and has a certain limits against the use of the software. Here the source code is not downloadable. It is completely owned by the developer itself. Hence it will not even allow for any kind of modifications. Okay. Moving on to the next kind of software, that is a freeware. The very interested one, that's a freeware. It's a kind of a software which is available for the free of cost and which allows for copying and further distribution also, but not for the modification. It will not allow for the modification and whose source code is not available. That means it allows you to copy that software. That means you can download that software and after downloading you can share it with someone else, but source code will not be downloaded. If source code is not downloaded, obviously you will not be able to make any kind of modifications in it. I can give an example for this: Microsoft Internet Explorer, Adobe Reader, yes, Google Chrome, and Skype. Now, this kind of software, it's not open source software, nor it's a freeware. Okay, nor it's a free software. The freeware is entirely different, where it is allowing you to copy the software, use the software. Free of cost it is, but it is not allowing you to download its source code. That means this Google Chrome, it will easily get installed into your computer system, but the source code of this Google Chrome will not get installed in your computer system. It will not allow for the source code to get downloaded only. Such kinds of software which are freely available but no modifications can be done, such software I can call it as a freeware. I hope you people are understanding what was a proprietary software, what is a freeware. Moving on to the next kind of a software, that's a shareware. Okay, all these kinds of, you know, software we are using currently, but we doesn't know what exactly they are being called as, why they are called as freeware. Now, after watching this video, you can, the applications which are installed in your computer or the laptop, you can make out what are the softwares that belongs to the freeware, shareware, or the proprietary softwares. Moving on to the shareware, it's a kind of a software which is made available to the right to redistribute copies. That means you can distribute these copies after the, you know, you can distribute these copies. I mean, a copy of a software you can share with your friend, but it has been stipulated that if one intends to use the software often, after a certain period of a time, then a license fee should be paid. I can show you here one of the example of WinRAR. You know, some kind of a software comes for the trial basis, you know, for 1 month or for 15 days it gives you the trial basis, and after 15 days it says that your license has been expired, you need to buy for that product. So this is what is compress encrypt package. This is WinRAR is compress. It is used for compressing, encrypting package and backup utility with only one utility. That's it's a kind of a software where it provides you a trial version. Maybe for 15 to 20 days it performs a trial version, and later it starts giving a pop-up message that license is expired. You need to buy it. You need to make a payment and then buy the full version of it. So shareware can also be termed as the trialware, where it's a kind of a proprietary software that is provided to users on a limited basis, and only for certain limited trials it will provide you, where it gives more potential for the users to for the opportunity to try out the software on a limited basis for the limited time and judge whether that software is useful before purchasing a license for the full version of the software. After using this WinRAR software, you'll get to know what is its performance, and you can judge whether its software is a good one or not before buying it by making a payment. Okay, you can have a trial version. Then if you feel good, then you can buy it. Okay, the full version of that particular software. After the usage of the software for several times, the software may present a dialog box like this at startup or the during usage. Okay, just like reminding the user to purchase it. This is all about the shareware. In case of shareware, the thing is here, the source code will not be available. When you download the software, only the software can be downloaded. When you purchase it, full version of that software, only the software is getting downloaded. Source codes will not be allowed, and modifications of the softwares are also not allowed. I hope the concept is clear. Moving on to the next concept, World Wide Web. As we have studied this terminology many a times, the World Wide Web is a set of protocols that allow the users to access any document over the internet. It might be the, you know, audio file, video file, text file, image file, any kind of the document over the internet, you can make it available through a naming system based on URLs. Naming system in the sense, having the website names. Okay, World Wide Web, it also specifies a way the hypertext transfer protocols. These are the protocols that are helping the World Wide Web in order to request, okay, in order to request for a document over the internet. Before, we used the internet only for the text-based information, but now it's not so. Internet has gained more its popularity because of the usage of graphics, like, you know, it allows for the audios, videos, images, okay, then text files, PDF file, images, like, you know, PNG images, JPG images, all kinds of graphics it allows. Hence, the World Wide Web has become more, you know, popular over the internet in order to download, fine, or uploading. Moving on to the next topic, that is the Telnet. So, Telnet is a protocol, like in how World Wide Web Hypertext Transfer Protocol is the basic protocol that was helping the World Wide Web. That means in order to access any kind of documents over the internet, Hypertext Transfer Protocol is helping. The same way, the another protocol that is helping the World Wide Web is the Telnet. We know this, what is Telnet is. Most of the times we have already discussed about this. Telnet is a kind of internet utility that allows you to log on to the remote computer system. So most of the times we have already discussed what is this Telnet. It's an internet utility in the sense it is one of the internet feature that helps the users to log on to the remote computer system. For an example, work from home. Any person who is working from home, he or she needs to get an access to the computer system which is there in their office. They will be usually given with the login details. Okay. So when they request to access the computer system from their, you know, from their office, a command prompt will be there. Okay, a login page command prompt will appear on their system. They have to put all their credentials. Okay. And once if it is, the request is sent, it will be matched. If the credentials are correct, then that particular person, he or she, will be provided with an access to the computer system in their office. Now, who is helping in all these is the Telnet protocol. This Telnet protocol, it actually gives a character-based terminal window on another system. That's what I said. So it will, whenever the request has been made, it provides a command prompt with the login details. So if you are providing, it will provide you the access. Example, you will usually get a login prompt on that system. If you have permitted the access, you can work on that particular system in your office. And it doesn't make any, it doesn't makes you any kind of difference that you are working at home, okay, or if you are working at the office. The access level will be the same. And one more software example I can give of the software, TeamWeaver. TeamWeaver is also, you know, that is kind of makes use of extensive use of Telnet. Think that I'm in Hubli, one of my friend is in Bangalore, and if I'm facing any of the problem in my computer system, then through the help of this TeamWeaver software, if we share the IP address directly, he can able to get complete access on my computer system. Even though I'm physically present just before my system, he can open my folders in my computer system. He can, you know, access all the documents from my computer system. Now, how this is happening is because of Telnet protocol that helps you to log in onto the remote system. What is this remote system? Any system where we cannot physically go and access the contents. Through certain protocol, if we need to access, then that it is a Telnet protocol which is helping you to access such kinds of resources on the another computer system. The Telnet also helps to connect to the thousands of catalogs at libraries around the world. Now, what is this library catalog? Is nothing but it's a kind of database that allows you to search for certain things like maybe books, journals, magazines, okay, any kind of government documents, etc. So such kinds of, you know, you can even search for those documents over the internet by making use of the Telnet protocol. Moving on to the next one, that's a web browser. We all know what the web browser is. So web browser is a worldwide web client. That means a web browser is a worldwide web software that helps you to navigate through the worldwide web, and it actually displays the web pages which are being requested by the user over the internet. Isn't it through the maybe Chrome? I have the web browser Chrome in my computer system. So as in I open my web browser, okay, with the help of World Wide Web, I will start typing what I need. I'll request for Facebook.com. So this web browser will navigate to the Facebook server. Then it displays, then it provides a response to me and then displays a web page that is a login web page of that Facebook.com. Isn't it? Examples, you know, like Internet Explorer, Google Chrome, Mozilla, Opera, Safari, Netscape Navigator. These are some of the examples for the web browser. Moving on to the next one topic, that's the web server. So web server also we have discussed many a times. So web server is a kind of a worldwide web server that actually responds to the request made by the web browser. Okay, so you can see here, the web browser right now present here is Chrome. Whatever the web browser is providing the request, it reaches to the server here, web server, and web server responds back to the web browser. Now in web browser, who is actually making the requesting? It's the we, the users. Whatever the user requests to the web server through the web browser, maybe any of the website it might be, or any of the applications like Facebook, YouTube, Yahoo, whatever it is, the web server will respond back to the web browser, but in the form of web page itself. Okay, I hope the concepts are clear to you. In our next video, with a few more topics we will discuss. Till that, take care of yourself. Thank you, students.